All right. Hello, everyone. So I'm Max, and I'm going to present our work on modeling sparse information diffusion at scale via lazy multivariate talks processes, which is joint work with MATLAB. Okay, so let me jump right into it. So temporal point processes in general are an important framework to model data where discrete events are localized in continuous time and where the intervals between events are important and meaningful quantities. So, and it turns out that there are lots of real-world problems that fall into this category, and consequently, our TPPs have found applications in a lot of different domains, including social and information systems, which is what we are looking at here, but also in fields like climate science, health, finance, neuroscience, and many more. So, in this work, we focus specifically on multivariate talks processes, which are an important class of TPPs that, in a way, allow to model event sequences with mutual excitations, and as such, they are very promising to model diffusion processes. However, what's unfortunate is that they are notoriously hard to scale, and this is because the runtime complexity of standard maximum likelihood estimation for this class of models is of the order of x times h. So where x refers to the set of entities that you have in your data, and h refers to the number of event sequences. Well, so this runtime complexity is in a way far too expensive for modeling large information diffusion processes, as they're common in social information systems, where the number of entities and the number of sequences can easily be in the millions. And so this is unfortunate because it, in some way, MHPs are really one of the most promising class of methods to model these kind of processes. At the same time, we can't apply them to large scale domains because they don't scale enough. However, one important observation with regard to these large scale diffusion processes is that they are typically very sparse. And by sparse, I mean that if I take a single cascade, then out of the millions of possible entities that could participate in the cascade, only very, very few actually do. So what I'm showing here are two examples of public data sets, namely Meme Tracker and Reddit hyperlinks. So a Meme Tracker in particular consists of event sequences which capture when a particular meme or phrase appeared on a particular website. So if we group this data by memes, then we get something like 75 million cascades, one for each meme, and something like over 1.3 million websites. So if we now have a runtime complexity of x times h, so 75 million times 1.3 million, that's clearly bad. However, when we look at each of the sequences on its own, then what we can see is that only very few of all possible websites actually occur in a particular meme sequence. So that means if I look at one particular phrase, it appeared only on very few websites of all out of all possible ones. So if you look at the right side here of the plot, what you can see is that in fact for the vast majority of cascades or event sequences, less than 0.0001% of domains are actually active in one of these sequences. And this is obviously nice because this is a kind of sparsity. And then our question was, well, can we design a model that can somehow exploit this kind of sparsity such that we can scale better? And then the nice thing is, it turns out we can. And this is, in a way, the main contribution of our work to develop a model that can exploit this. So the main idea of our approach is to design an inference procedure that needs to consider only the entities that occur in the sequence and not all non-occurring ones too. And I'm not going into much technical detail here since the derivations are somewhat involved. However, what I'd like to do is to give you some kind of high-level idea of how this works. So what we're doing is that we take a standard MHP model, what I'm showing here on the right side at the top box, but then use a specific parameterization of this MHP, where the important part is that we use a non-negative matrix factorization for the alpha matrix, which basically models the mutual excitation patterns in the model. And so this current parameterization is the middle box on the right side here. And so the important part is that because of this non-negative factorization, we can rewrite the loss function of the maximum likelihood estimator in a way that we need to sum only over the embeddings of the entities that are active in an episode and not over all entities. And this works because, in a way, of the linear structure of the factorization, such that we can rewrite the sum over all entities that are not present in an episode as the sum over all entities, which I'm calling u hat here at the box at the bottom, minus the sum of the entities that occur in the episode. And the nice thing is that the second term has a much smaller runtime complexity than the first, because we need to compute u hat only once for all event sequences. So overall, what we get is a basically combined model and inference procedure, where we now have a runtime complexity that is of the order of x plus h, so not x times h. So in detail, x plus h times e, where e is the average number of entities that occur in a sequence. And as I've shown in the slide before, e is obviously much smaller than x, which can give us really big scalability gains on sparse cascades. So let me show you this a bit on some experiments where we evaluated this empirically. So what we did is that we took some pre-existing subsets of meme tracker in a way that were small enough such that we can apply standard methods on it. And so these subsets consist of phrases that are related to different topics where these phrases are grouped about. So one of the topics is, for instance, Amy Winehouse, one is Arrow Spring, one is bailout, one is Miami Heat. So what I'm showing on this plot here is the upper row is basically the x-axis is the runtime of a method, and the y-axis is then basically the percentage of the processed sequences that we have processed so far. So in a way, this plot measures how long it takes one method to make one pass through the data set. And what we're comparing is basically standard maximum likelihood estimation, which is the blue line, our lazy MHPs, which is the red line, and also neural hawks processes, which is one of the state-of-the-art methods for deep learning-based approaches to parameterizing MHPs, which is the black dotted line. And so the lower row shows a similar comparison, but now the y-axis is not how much of the data set we have processed, but the log likelihood of the model, meaning it shows how fast we are learning a good model. Well, so the big takeaway message from this plot is that our approach, the lazy MHPs, offer speedups by multiple orders of magnitude on this kind of data. And this is really significant. So for instance, for the Amy Winehouse case, right, the maximum likelihood estimator, the standard one, takes something of 2.6 times 10 to the power of 4 seconds to make one pass through the data, versus the lazy MHP only takes 3.3 seconds. So this can be huge gains. And this is obviously nice. And in a way, it's given the runtime analysis that we showed before, it might not be surprising because E is exactly multiple orders of magnitude smaller than X on these sparse cascades. But it's obviously nice that this to see that this translates really directly into empirical gains too. Okay, so now a reasonable question that you might ask is if you make any kind of approximations in our inference method that might impact the quality of the model to achieve this kind of scalability. So one thing that we indeed need is this kind of specific parameterization that I talked of before about to enable, which enables the scalability. However, beyond that, we don't make any kind of approximation, such as, for instance, sampling the compensator or stuff like that. And in fact, we compute the exact likelihood and gradients of the model. And what this means is that we recover the parameters of the model as well as any state-of-the-art method, as long as the true model, in a way, is included in the extension of our parameterization. So, and we evaluated this with a couple of experiments on synthetic data, Yeah, we knew basically the ground truth parameters, and we show that we indeed recover them as well as these kind of state-of-the-art methods, and also that we are performing better than methods that you need some kind of approximations like sampling with compensator to achieve scalability on burst event sequences. Okay, so and finally, in addition to the scalability gains and this kind of nice property that we compute the actual exact gradient and likelihood, what I also wanted to mention is that what's nice is that we get latent factors from the factorization that are nicely interpretable since they are non-negative, and in that way can be interpreted as a soft clustering. So I'm illustrating this here on a smaller data set, namely the State Policy Innovation and Diffusion Database, which consists of policies that have been enacted in US states, as well as their year of adoption. So and what political scientists have used MHPs for in this context, for instance, is to understand the influence structure among US states, so namely whether the adoption of a policy in one state also predicts the adoption of the same policy in a different state later on. And what's nice is, first of all, that our model does learn reasonable influence structures on this data set, which are in line with other models. So for instance, what I'm showing here is in the middle are two plots for New York and Tennessee. And what you can see is that New York is influential for Northeastern states, as well as California, for instance, whereas Tennessee is much more influential for Southern Eastern states. But what's also interesting is that we get, in a way, latent factors from the factorization that provide a nice clustering of all these different states, and as such provides further insights into the structure of this data. And well, since we have a really scalable method, what we can now do is to do the same thing for large data sets and gain similar insights. So what I'm showing here is some clusters that we get when we apply our method to the Reddit hyperlinks data set that I talked about before. And what you can see is that we get really nice topically consistent clusters, which basically group these different subreddits according to different topics that were not observed, right? So we have basically a music cluster, some movies clusters, some sports clusters, and so on. And we get this very straightforward from a large data set, well, at least medium scale data sets, so like 55,000 entities, 860,000 sequences. And I haven't seen personally MHPs being applied to this kind of large data sets in this context. But in fact, we could actually process significantly larger data sets too. Okay, so that was most of what I wanted to talk about. So to summarize, what we did in this work is to propose a new parameterization for MHPs called lazy MHPs that allows to exploit characteristic sparsity patterns of real-world information cascades. And through that, we can use this model to understand such diffusion processes at previously unattainable scale. But simultaneously, we are able to compute the exact likelihood and gradients of the model such that we can infer high quality models. In addition, we get this kind of nice interpretability to get additional insights into the data set. So thank you for attending the talk. That was what I wanted to talk about. Unfortunately, this is all still virtual, so we can't discuss as easily as in in-person conferences. However, if you have any questions, feedback, suggestions, please feel free to reach out to us via email. So I've listed my email here on the slide. It's also on the paper, of course. So yeah, thank you again, and I'm looking forward to hearing from you.